Hi everybody, it's Ken Bach, and I'm here with Scott Mandelker in our long-running series. Today, Scott, we're gonna talk to Scott about the tarot, which is quite a departure from the two podcasts that we've done before, which are mainly about extraterrestrials and, you know, the higher cosmology in the universe. First of all, Scott, welcome.
Thank you for having me again.
Now, the tarot seemingly is a very different topic from extraterrestrials, but yet it is covered in the raw material or the law of one material, of which you are I consider you a scholar of the law of one material. And that just speaks to the really wide-ranging and far-ranging coverage of Ra, and there are some links here, as I've just found out, with the origins of the tarot with Ra. Do you want to talk about that first?
The teachings on the tarot that Ra gives in the Law of One series or the Ra material books was originally in volume 4, still in volume 4. Mm-hmm. And so it represents the last portion of what they communicated to the LNL research group through Carla Ruckert, questioning still by Don Elkins. Mm-hmm. And very much builds on all the previous teachings centered around healing and transformation of mind, body, spirit. Mm-hmm. And therefore it's the most difficult. And I did a study group in San Francisco in the 90s, and we went right through the first three volumes, and we disbanded in the middle of the fourth. And I'm doing a Skype study group, and we went right through all four PDFs that I compiled from Ra, and we're deep into the last one of archetypes now, Tarot. And it's hard to get out because it's very thick. So it represents the advanced teachings of Ra to the LNL research group. So that has to be borne in mind. And it's very challenging. Mm. So the link between extraterrestrials and the tarot through Ra is that Ra claims, first of all, to be a sixth density extraterrestrial group working with a confederation of planets that help the evolution of life in the solar system. Mm. Among other solar systems. And that's the Confederation of Planets, as they call it. Mm-hmm. Confederation of Planets in service to the One Infinite Creator. I don't know if that's their real name, but it's they have that spirit. Mm-hmm. And so Ra claims to have built the Giza Pyramid. Ra gave extensive information on the function and the metaphysics of the King's Chamber, the Queen's Chamber, the Underground Chamber, and the formation of the Pyramid, Giza Pyramid, which they say they built by thought and not by, they said they made it out of everlasting rock, meaning they said they communicated to the beingness in the rock, the allness of the rock, which is basically the higher energy fields of the rock, the mineral, and were able to shape it according to their design. And so there's no way that scientists can understand how the Egyptian slaves built the pyramid, because they didn't. Mm. It was built by mind, by Ra, and in one piece appeared instantaneously overnight.
That kind of reminds me of the quote by Jesus. It says, if you say over to that mountain, move, and it will move, or something like that. I'm paraphrasing.
Yes, yes. That's the power of mind wielding force that can change the conditions of matter, create matter, destroy matter, move it around. And then, of course, there are technologies with sound also. But interestingly, it's very esoteric. The physical sound that could be made that could shatter glass or esoterically move rock is another form of sound of the thought of the adept, or Ra, that was able to form the rock of the Giza Pyramid. They're both forms of vibration or sound. One is verbal, vocal, audible, and the other one is mental. And they're both vibratory Vibratory telekinesis, you can say.
Yeah.
So the point is that Ra claims to have given that the origin of the tarot is basically the priests of that time, around the time of Akhenaten, 3,500 years ago, who were taught by Ra directly, who created the images of only the 22 major arcana cards. And
those are the trumps, yeah?
The trumps, yeah. The major arcana, 22 cards. That's all the tarot was originally, according to Ra. And it was a system of teaching for the initiates who were working with the pyramid and working with elder teachers for transformation of mind, body, spirit. So it was a training tool. It was a training form that was used to trigger deeper inner work. And so the origin of the tarot, beyond Ra giving it in this form to those priests and the work that was done by the initiates, the origin is actually that this represents what Ra calls the philosophical foundations of the transformation of mind, body, spirit. So Ra said, the philosophy, and I'm quoting from actually session 77, and you can see it on the website and on my PDF. Ra said, the philosophy, meaning the philosoph— what Don was asking, what's the philosophical basis or foundation for what was created in our seven-dimensional octave? The philosophy for experience and transformation for the human level in 3D in the solar system. And so it's the tarot is basically an approximation of the philosophical foundations created by the Logos, by the creator of this seven-dimensional solar system, for transformation of our being in third density physical. And so there's an extremely orderly structure to the 22 cards. Namely, the first seven represent a cycle of mind, the second seven, body, the third seven, spirit, and card 22 is called the choice, which really represents the capacity for harvesting or graduating out of 3D physical and moving into density.
And 22, what's 22? What's card 22 in the major arcana?
You mean what's the name of that card?
Yeah.
It's called the choice. Ra calls it the choice.
Is that what it's called in the regular tarot?
I see. Okay, no, actually, it seems that they're what's called card zero, or the fool, is, yeah, that's interesting. You know, I confess, this is the area of the raw material that I know the least, because my personal studying, I, you know, found that it was just not necessary for me.
Yeah.
And now I'm learning a lot by teaching it. Card 22 is the same as card 0 or non-numbered, which is the fool.
And okay.
The fool in Ra system is called the choice.
Yeah.
That's very, very interesting. But it's premature to explain that or get into that right now.
Gotcha. Okay.
We go to the other ones.
Yeah, it's interesting because I'm looking— I mean, I'm sure this is going to confuse matters, but I'm looking at the Crowley deck. And, you know, the last card in the major arcana is the universe, 21. But yeah, the fool is 0.
Yeah, it's anyway. 20. What Ra calls 22 is the fool, or non-numbered, or 0.
Gotcha.
So Ra was saying, the philosophy, I'm quoting, the philosophy was to create a foundation, first of mind, then of body, and then of spiritual complex. And so these concept— what another term that Ra uses is concept complexes. Each of the 22 cards is a complex of ideas. And there's a perfectly orderly progression from 1 through 7 in each of the 7. So there's 1 through 7, which is 1 through 7, the series of mind, and then 8 through 15, and then 9 through 21. I'm sorry, no, 15 through 21. And then there are correspondences between 1, 8, and 15, and 1 and 2, or 8 and 9. And so there are internal correspondences or relations, and then there are connections between that position in each of the series, one pos each position in each of the three series.
Wow, that's really profound.
Yeah, so I mean, I'll give the basic. It's very profound, and the order is matrix, potentiator, catalyst, experience, significator, transformation, and great way. So this is, heavy upon heavy, right? What the heck is a what is the potentiator of a matrix? My God. And then there's matrix of mind, matrix of body, matrix of spirit. Potentiator of mind, potentiator of body, potentiator of spirit, and then each one, right? So there's what's the relationship between the significator of mind and the catalyst of spirit?
I'm a bit lost.
Right.
What
So
do you want to begin with a little bit of, do you want to go into that first? What is a significator?
well, no, I'm not going to go that way. I think it's better to go from the general to the specific. And the point is that there's a fixed name to each position in each series of seven. So cards 1 and 8 and 15 are called matrix. Cards not 2 and 9 and 16 are called potentiator. And then in each series, there's a catalyst, there's an experience, meaning catalyst of mind, catalyst of body, catalyst of spirit, and then the next nodal position is experience. And then significator, and then two final in each series is a transformation and a great way card. Okay. Now, these archetypes of being 777 have clearly a relation to the seven chakras. They have a relation to the seven densities, but it's not a one-to-one correspondence. And so if you're looking for that, if someone's looking for that, they won't find it, but there's a close relation. And so we can just start, wherever you want. What's important is understand that this is considered the most advanced level of the healing and initiation of mind. So there's Don asked, then the LNL group asked Ra, help us become healers, teach us to become a healer. Ra said, okay. Here is the fundamental teaching on the healing of mind and body and spirit, meaning heal yourself, meaning first you do your own work, and only the one who's healed oneself is a healer, no one else actually. And healers are effective to the degree that they have done the inner work. The inner work, the first four level, this so this represents the fifth level of the initiation of the healing initiation of mind. The first four levels, which is another talk we can get into, which was in my Healing and Balance PDF, is discover the completeness and the polarities of your own mind, and then accept and understand them. Discover and
Sorry, Scott, just to hold up. What do you mean by initiation? Is that movement from one density into another?
No, not necessarily. What Ra calls harvest or graduation from one density to another, which is the capacity for a soul to be reborn in a higher dimensional position. It's actually the person has developed their energy field, their seven chakra system, their mind and consciousness, to the extent that they no longer need this dimensional experience or the catalyst of this 3D. So that harvest ability is a metaphysics and an energetic matter. And of course, it's related to consciousness. And so the meek shall inherit the earth, said Yeshua, meaning those who are working from fourth chakra or love, universal unconditional love to some extent, to a required degree, will graduate or will be with the earth in its fourth density experience to come. So that would be considered a type of initiation. That's the big one. But any kind of awakening to a new condition of mind associated with a greater realization of unity, the law of one. You know, Ra said that healing is a recognition of the a greater recognition of the law of one, which just means that there's greater balance and integrity or internal integration of body, mind, spirit.
Would you say so, it's a form of mind training?
It's mind, body, spirit training.
Okay.
So the first four levels of the healing initiation of mind. See, the goal is harvest ability.
Mm-hmm.
These teachings are for 3D people. The initiates were 3D people, even if they were wanderers. And even for us, if we're a wanderer, these teachings are quite valid. So the first four levels are basically coming to discover and accept the polarities in your own mind, the completeness of your own mind. I am a sinner, I am a saint, I am great, and I am miserable. I am all that is, and so is you. So are you, so is all. The wholeness of mind, and then accepting it and understanding it in self and then with other. Those are the first four trainings. After that comes the study of what Ra called the ratios and proportions of the deep mind. And that's this study of Tarot. And all of that is just the healing and initiation of mind. After that is the healing initiation of body and then spirit. So that's what those guys were doing. You know? The initiates in Egypt, what were they doing? They were actually plumbing the depths of their own distortions and bringing love and awareness into, and thereby transforming mind, body, spirit, and being capable of graduation.
And is that the same as the mystery schools?
Yes, of course.
Mm.
Yeah, I mean, so people have a mystified view of what those guys were doing. They think, you know, they're sitting around doing magic all day long, or who knows what. They were looking into their own personal psychology. They were looking into their own personal distortions, and then also seeing the true nature more clearly, their own true nature. And then, you know, just like any kind of deep Buddhist path, particularly Theravadan or Vipassana, seeing the mind, accepting it, understanding it, bringing love and compassion to self and other, and then seeing through it all into one's true nature. So all of this with the Tarot is basically advanced training in the development of mind. But the nature of the 22 cards themselves are the blueprint for soul evolution in 3D. So studying the blueprint for soul evolution in 3D, body, mind, spirit development, to harvest ability, that study is a portion of the healing initiation of mind in 3D. Okay, so clearly it's advanced. And Ross said then what was also added to it was the Sumerian, Chaldean, Mesopotamian astrological systems of divination that were not of Ra and are not necessary or useful generally for an understanding of the Tarot as the foundations for our transformation in 3D. The astrological Ra felt, in this case, was not necessary to consider with this Tarot system they gave.
So do we know what came from the Mesopotamians versus what came from Ra? In terms of the cards and the structure?
Yes. Don asked about particular symbols and iconography in different cards. And Ra many times said this was an astrological addition. You don't need to consider it. Or it wasn't part of what we were teaching. So like the stars or particular things that were held in their hands or certain things around in each card were astrological additions later, not of Ra. Okay. So if we get into any particular cards, we can see that.
I see.
So again, these are concept complexes. They represent, in many ways, the blueprint of the creator of this solar system for the evolution of mind, body, spirit in 3D. And Ra said there were two other systems of studying the archetypes or the deep mind structure. One was the Tree of Life, Kabbalah, and the other one was astrology. So Ra's not saying astrology is useless. They're just saying that it wasn't what they were teaching here. And yet it could be, and ideally, quite a valid way of studying the archetypes of the deep mind or the blueprint for evolution.
Now, Scott, I just want to back up and talk and ask about Ra. Now, obviously, in Egyptology, Ra is the sun god. So are we really saying here that Ra in the Ra material is the same Ra?
Well, you know, later, you see, if an extraterrestrial or some great master appears in my room, I may say, wow, you're a great being, my teacher. And I tell my friend or I tell my student, and 150 years from now, they say, oh, you know, the supreme God appeared to him in his room. And so there's a deification that is developed historically.
Right.
And Ra never gave themselves, you know, they don't even, their name is not Ra. It's just... You know, they didn't have that name before they were in touch with Akhenaten. That's not their name, because that's just how it's the resonance between Don's, or not Don, but Akhenaten's understanding of unity, which is symbolized by his worship of the sun as the monotheistic symbol of the one infinite creator. That
right.
was Akhenaten's mind. That
right.
was his view. And then...
And Akhenaten was the one that did away with the multi... what do you call that?
Yeah.
Many gods and made it worship of one god, right?
Yes, yes. Actually, it's interesting. I believe that the god that was worshipped... I mean, there were many gods before and many gods after. But the one that was quite troublesome was a worship of Ra. that was not actually worship of the one creation, or the one creator. It was sort of animist. So Ra, or that the group from Venus, there is this group, never claimed to be a god. Yet later Egyptian mythology and religion and the institutions, perhaps I guess, deified. This being, and made it a god. And
okay.
So it's not that Ra says we are the sun, but Ra is basically saying we also recognize the unity of all life.
Mm-hmm.
And if you call the name Ra, believing, you know, that you're seeking guidance from the one infinite source of love and light, very benevolent, you got us. Because we agree, we see it that way too, and we'd be happy to help you.
Okay.
Meaning that's what they, how they approached Akhenaten.
Yeah. And just to ask another general question, now this is would you say it's a series of divination? What is divination, first of all?
First of all, this is not anything to do with divination.
Okay.
Nothing zero whatsoever. It's not about fortune telling. It's not about character reading. It's not about future scrying. It's not about finding hidden secrets of facts and figures or the phenomena of human life. Nothing at all. This and that just shows you how far it's fallen,
wow.
How far the original intent has devolved into a system of entertainment.
Mm-hmm.
So. Ra didn't present this as divination. They were presented as training aids, training guidance, a training system for the initiates at that time to develop the overall understanding of what's the discipline. It's the discipline of understanding. Ra used that term, that's another term for the spiritual path, the discipline of understanding. Understanding self and other and all in its true nature.
Mm-hmm.
And this was an advanced portion of the study of the foundations of evolution in 3D. So, and that's done after people have worked through their anger, their sorrow, and their fear. their low self-esteem, their blockages of second, third chakra. So after the first four levels, which is about, you know, find your wholeness and accept it, find the wholeness of other and accept that too, and then understand it and take adequate responsibility and bring love and wisdom into it all, then later there would be the advanced study of the philosophical foundations for our evolution, which is this. So it's not about divination at all. It's about understanding the blueprint for soul evolution in 3D. The seven stages of development of mind and of body and of spirit, those seven stages are the same in, there are seven stages for each of those three cycles, mind, body, spirit. And the study of it is an advanced portion of the development of mind.
So, wow, I mean, that's quite something, because I'm sure a lot of people think the tarot is a system of divination. And, you know, I think I use the deck for, I ask a question, I pull a card, you know, and I see what it means. So would you say that that's not a right way of approaching it?
I wouldn't say there's a right or wrong. And I would say that if it works for you, you know, go right ahead.
Mm-hmm.
I've used it that way too. I've actually done readings, you know, at parties long, long ago. But that's, you know, it's like having a top class sports car and driving it 20 miles an hour in the street, in the city, you know,
okay,
to the grocery store.
Okay.
So that it's like it's just a significant lack of use of its true potential,
right,
making not much use of its total potential.
Okay.
So but the only way to use it or to begin to use it in the way it was originally presented by Ra to the initiates 3,500 years ago is to study what Ra said about it and the portions of the raw material that are about it. And that's the purpose of my putting together the PDF. So I have a PDF on my site called Tarot and Archetypal or Archetypal Mind. It's 70 pages. And it came just, it's a compilation of quotes from a website called lawofone.info. And I do my commentary in the Skype group, and we have over a dozen videos up around it now. So you'd have to basically understand, you know, what do they mean? Each of the 22 cards means what? And how does it relate to my path?
Wow.
So like, I can give you an example.
Yeah.
Unless you have a question.
No, I think an example would be good because we've been kind of dancing around.
Yeah.
It'd be good to talk about specific. Yeah.
Yeah, so let's look at the first seven cards, which are the cycle of mind.
Mm-hmm.
And as I said before, each of the seven positions in each of the three cycles, mind and body and spirit,
yeah,
each of the seven has a particular name, and it's the same for each of the three cycles. So it's matrix, potentiator, catalyst, experience, significator, then transformation, and great way.
Right.
And so there are internal relations between the different these different archetypes in each of the seven positions, in that the matrix, like you'll see, matrix of mind in the typical tarot deck is called the magician.
Mm-hmm.
And you see in the Rider-Waite deck, a guy holding a staff above a table that has symbols of the four elements.
Okay, hold up. Let me just load up the Rider-Waite deck here. Sorry, go on. I'll look
sure
at the cards as you're speaking.
So he's got his right hand up, holding a staff or something looks like a candle.
Yeah.
Right arm up, holding the staff to the sky. Left arm down, pointing to the earth. Infinity symbol on his head, so he's making a top left bottom right diagonal,
mm-hmm,
with the symbols of the four the four suits of the tarot, being the earth, water, air, fire, being coins, cups, swords, and wands on the table in front of him. Fine. Called the magician. Now, in the tarot as presented by Ra, this is called the matrix of mind. And the matrix of mind is conscious mind. The conscious, what we are conscious of in the in our ordinary personality experience of what I'm thinking, what I'm feeling. So in Buddhism, that basically represents our consciousness of sensation, perception, thought, feeling, memory, image, imagination, fantasy, you know, and the deep beliefs and the deep patterns of the mind that are generally unconscious that come up sometimes. So what we're consciously aware of is the stuff of the conscious mind. And card one, being matrix of mind, the position matrix is basically the condition of one of the three, one of these three vehicles, vehicle of mind and the vehicle of body and the vehicle of spirit, one of these three tools in the hand of higher self or in our own manifest experience, before it's been worked upon. The conscious mind is what you start with.
Right. So this is the blank slate, like the receptacle.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of the screen of mind. It's like the sky without clouds. The clouds precipitate out of the water that arises from the ocean into the sky, and then clouds are formed. The formation of clouds are basically the contents of consciousness. But consciousness in and of itself is an open sky. And so Ra says that that of itself, consciousness is unmoved. And so it's like the sky, you know, it's a space within which elements may manifest and change. So within the space of mind, within consciousness, with it, which itself is unmoving, then there may be potentiation. Potentiation is actually the unconscious. And so in the tarot deck, card two is the High Priestess. So it represents in Ra's system the unconscious. The unconscious is the potentiator of mind. And so there's a lovely quote. Ra said, without potentiation, the conscious mind has no inwardness. Without potentiation, the conscious mind has no inwardness. And the inwardness, which is soul, you know, you can say it's soulful music. Well, what does that mean? It means that that what is manifest touches and resonates with what is deep. And what's deep is one's heart and one's knowing, truth and love. And that's fourth and fifth chakra. So, interestingly enough, one can say that an ordinary second and third chakra consciousness, consciousness of selfhood, consciousness of place in society, or group and relationship, that ordinary consciousness of body and personality, and one's personal sense of one's identity, a common identity, and the sense of a group, place in society, relationships, that second, third chakra consciousness. When there's potentiation, then there's a movement into fourth and fifth chakra. Meaning, when we seek within, heart opens and wisdom flows. And so the potentiation of the conscious mind is spiritual seeking. And people who don't do that remain shallow and superficial. And when we don't do that, we become shallow and superficial, lacking inwardness. And so the High Priestess is the activator of the conscious mind, which means the conscious mind, like a male, that's another set, it's another principle in the 22 cards, is that they're either male or female. And they're also looking right, left, or center. They're either standing or sitting. They're wearing this or they're wearing that. All of that's not astrological. And all of that has significance to understand this feature of our being. So in some cases, the archetype card represents some aspect of the total being. Sometimes it represents a process of the total being. Total being in this case meaning mind, body, spirit. So card one is the magician. Card two is the high priestess. The high priestess is the potentiator of the matrix. And that's what's important. Ross says, it's to be noted again that in of itself, consciousness is unmoved. Mm-hmm. The male needs the female in this sense. The potentiator,
so it's a seed of spiritual awakening.
Yeah, it's the reservoir of our true being.
Okay.
And making connection or delving into the reservoir of our being, deep mind, is the seed of awakening.
Right.
You know, awakening occurs because of the consciousness seeking its own depths, seeking its own potentiation within, not by following the guru, but by finding the inner guru, or by finding God within, you know, finding the inner divinity. So Ra said, in each infinitesimal part of yourself resides the one infinite creator in all its power. And so in each aspect of our being, there is one, and there is great power. And when we don't seek within, we don't know it. And that's the heresy of materialism. Heresy in the sense that it takes people away from soul, and it leaves this conscious mind shallow.
Okay.
So the potentiator of consciousness, card two, is called the unconscious, and that is what the conscious mind draws upon to make sense of life and to choose path and to transform itself.
Do you want to... sorry. Yeah, I see how how this can go on for hours and hours. But I think it'd be good to just talk about the seven, you know, the matrix potentiator, catalyst, experience, significator, transformation, and great way, so that people get an idea. Because I mean, that seems to be a very big structure in which I've never seen before. That I've only seen the raw material. So let's cover that.
Okay. Well, reiterating about matrix and potentiator of mind, Ra says, as to its name, the name of magician is understandable when you consider that consciousness is the great foundation, mystery, and revelation, which makes this particular density possible. The self, and here's a classic line, the self-conscious entity is full of the magic of that which is to come. It may be considered first, for the mind is the first of the complexes to be developed by the student of spiritual evolution. The student of spiritual evolution is the seeker of initiation, which is us. The mind is the first of the three complexes, mind, body, spirit, to be considered and developed because it's central. It's central to our being. If the mind is messed up, you know, strong, wonderful body doesn't do much good. Spiritual development, meaning the development of powers, he has powers, goes awry terribly when the mind has not been well healed, as we know. So consciousness is the great foundation, mystery, and revelation, which makes this particular density possible. So in Buddhism, the Buddha said that even consciousness is born of ignorance, meaning consciousness was one of the five skandhas, or heaps, the elements of common experience that we take to be real and solid and get attached to, consciousness. And only at higher levels, actually, of the spiritual path in Buddhism, does one see the emptiness of consciousness itself? So consciousness itself is not seen as penultimate by Ra or by the Buddha. And so in the yogic systems, they talk about supreme consciousness, God consciousness. That word wasn't used as the supreme state in Buddhism or by Ra. It's closer, what I would say is that like Nityananda presents awareness, infinite awareness, or Ra calls intelligent infinity.
Right.
That's our true mind. That's our true mind. The conscious mind is an artificially limited space in the sky. And so, but it is the foundation for revelation. And so in Hinduism, there's the idea of mind is the revealer.
Mm-hmm.
And so consciousness is really important, but it isn't the whole game. And so beyond having consciousness or being conscious, which itself is a miracle, a mystery, amazing kind of thing,
mm-hmm.
there are depths to the mind that are not yet manifest.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the key. And so Ra says, the matrix of mind is that from which all comes. It is unmoving, yet it is the activator in potentiation of all mind activity. So consciousness is that aspect of our body-mind-spirit complex, consciousness, from which all comes, meaning from which comes all defined self-experiencing, all defined experience whatsoever.
Hmm.
It is unmoving, yet it is the activator in potentiation of all mind activity, meaning it holds within it, as you sort of said, the seeds of awakening, because it rests upon an infinite ocean of deep mind, an infinite ocean of knowing.
Mm-hmm.
And so Ra said, then, the potentiator of mind, card 2, High Priestess, is that great resource which may be seen as the sea, S-E-A, the sea into which consciousness dips ever deeper and more thoroughly in order to create, ideate, and become more self-conscious.
Mm-hmm.
Consciousness dips ever deeper into the deep mind in order to create, to ideate, and to become more self-conscious, to illumine its nature, its distortions, and its true nature beyond that. And so that's the interplay of matrix and potentiator.
Mm-hmm.
And when Ra talked about the potentiator of mind, card 2, they're basically showing the feminine, it's a kind of, you know, like the muse. It's very much the muse. And interestingly, in the Egyptian deck that Ra gave to the initiates that is reproduced as best they could in volume 4 of the Ra material, the depiction is similar to that of the Crowley deck, or the Rider-Waite deck, and there's even a modern Egyptian deck. The modern Egyptian deck is closer to the Ra deck than Crowley or Rider-Waite. But what you see is a woman that looks like Carla Ruckert to me, sitting between two pillars. One is light, one is dark, and she has an ankh in the middle of her body,
mm-hmm.
and she's partially veiled. And that's because the deep mind is veiled by design, so that we may seek within.
And sorry to be way. Clear. To be clear, did the LL group do another set of cards based on what Ra told them?
You know, I
Is
don't
that
know.
What you said? Okay.
I actually don't know if they discovered this deck or they produced it themselves.
What is this deck called again?
Well, it's just it's called the Egyptian deck.
Egyptian
or,
deck.
It's different than the modern Egyptian deck. Modern Egyptian deck is not Ra's Egyptian deck.
Mm-hmm.
It may well be that this is commercially available, because in a number of cards there were some astrological symbols that Ra said you can dispense with. meaning they're not important. So it may be that this was this is a traditional commercially available Egyptian named Egyptian deck.
Okay.
But the interplay of magician and high priestess is key to everything, because it's only by seeking within and trusting the value, trusting the greatness and the value, the worth of our inner being. Only by that trust and faith can we develop.
Okay.
And that's why the great illness of our age is low self-value, mm-hmm. I think. People who don't trust themselves. I don't trust myself, or I don't know anything.
Yeah.
And so people ask me things like, well, what about this and what about that? And I say, well, if you want to know something, ask yourself. If you really want to know something, ask yourself.
Yeah.
And that sounds kind of funny, but it's spot on, I'd say.
Mm.
And so the difference between a person who dies confused, which is the case with most people on Earth, and those who die knowing, somewhat knowing, and well, and fine in moving through the transition to the next stage,
mm-hmm.
Is the difference between those who've sought within and those who have not. Mm-hmm. Going to religion and church and going to the guru and listening and saying what they say isn't necessarily seeking within. It may just be repetition of what you've been told. Seeking within is the key. And the key to it really is, you know, Ra says, recognition that self is a being of infinite worth. Self is a being of infinite worth.
Mm.
If your spiritual teaching doesn't say that, something's missing.
Yeah.
And the key then to the whole progression, the movement of development of consciousness through all these cards really is the quality of the interplay of cards 1 and 2, conscious mind and the deep mind.
Wow, interesting.
And then the second card is considered moving or active, while the first card, again, the matrix of mind, is unmoving. And so it's, that's a common idea that the creator needs his muse, and the male agent needs a female support. I mean, it doesn't have to be gender related, but fire depends on water, mystics would say.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I was going to ask you why, now this is really zooming out again, why is it mind, body, spirit? Why is body sandwiched between mind and spirit?
Ah, a good question. Well, first of all, I just answered some aspect of that before. Ra was saying that it's the importance of mind itself as being a microcosm of the Law of One. Mind contains all things.
Mm-hmm.
The mind as the function of revealing all experience. The importance of mind. That's why mind was put first.
Mm-hmm.
And in the initiatic process of transformation of our being, the first step is mind. Because, again, without clarity and balance in mind, then nothing else can be done well. And so Ra was saying that it's basically the importance of mind as being the foundation for our transformation is the reason why it's preceding the other two. The other reason is that when you talk about transformation of body, or the work on the seven cards, 8 through 15,
mm-hmm.
8 through 14, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 8 through 14, we're actually not talking about the physical body. We're talking about the energy body.
Ah.
And that is adept work. So you see, that's the funny thing about modern mystic traditions like Buddhism and Hinduism, in that almost all the people who are trying to get some kind of adept level magical training or mystical deeper transformation exercises and meditations and initiations haven't finished the healing of mind. That's why they have so much emotional stuff and there are all these conflicts in these groups. So you can't do magical work until you've purified second, third chakra blockages, until you are replete in love and wisdom, until you've love, you can love hate and you can love grief and you can love fear. Right. And then the mind has been healed. And then you walk around, you know, not emotionally reactive and free of the little sense of self. Then you work on body. And that's actually six chakra work. And there's a secret, but I shouldn't get into it very much, which is that in the Rider-Waite deck, cards 8 and 11, which are called Strength and Justice, are reversed, are a reversal of Ra's original presentation, where card 8 is Justice and card 11 is Strength. These cards happen to be the Matrix and the experience of body, right? Series of cards relating to mind is 1 through 7. Series of cards relating to body is 8 through 14, right? First card of any series is Matrix. The fourth card is always Experience. Card 8 being Matrix of body, in Ra's original presentation, is called Justice, or even Balanced Functioning. However, Rider-Waite is called Strength. If you see the modern Egyptian deck, it's been back, they put it back to Justice. But Mr. Rider and Mr. Waite consciously reversed it because they were they were on the left side of the path and they wanted to keep the hidden knowledge or keep the true knowledge hidden.
Wow, are you serious?
Yeah, and actually you can find material on that online. They admitted it. Mr. Rider or Mr. Waite, one of those fellows, admitted.
So they were service to self?
Of course.
Of course. Wow.
And actually, it's a very big deal, the reversal of these two cards, because card 8 represents the condition of the etheric body before working, and condition 11 represents the condition of the etheric body after significant working. And the etheric body is a six-chakra body, which is related to magic and power, power coming through, and it's used by white and black magicians.
Interesting. Well, the Crowley deck, with the Crowley deck, 8 is adjustment, which is justice, and 11 is lust, which is, well, it says courage, strength, energy, use of magical power, control of the life force, great love affair.
Yeah, I mean, look, I used the Crowley deck in the old days, but I don't, I think it's got some negative vibrations with it.
Ah, okay.
Because, of course, Crowley was a black magician. Simply, no judgment. He was a black, he was OTO. All that's occultism. It's all Illuminati.
What's OTO?
Ordo Templo, Ordo Templar Orientalis.
So he was...
OTO. It's the name of the group. Golden Dawn, all that.
So you think he was service to self as well?
Why do you think he called himself the Beast, 666? Was he service to others?
Well, I mean, it's interesting because I've been looking into writing by another gentleman who I'm in contact with. His name is Phil Misselberger, and his theory is that Crowley was just a rebel, although he was STO, and he didn't really care what other people thought of him.
Yeah, that's fine. But actually, if you look at his associates, they're not service to other. And if you look at the... I mean, I'm not a scholar on him, and I really don't care that much. But from everything I've read, and from how he presented himself, that's service to self. You know, service to other doesn't need magic. Okay? The Buddha said, the miracle of education far surpasses any miracles of magic cities, magic powers. And he actually said, because all these magic forms can be done by a technique, you know, to learn a mantra, to call the spirits, to move flowers around or appear odor in the room or whatever you want to do. Because it can be done by technical means and technique without transformation, I detest it. That's the phrase. I detest it, he said. Gautama. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I've met some people who do this and that. And honestly, it's very hard for somebody to be progressing deeply in the magical arts without going left. Because the magical arts are really used with a very unpurified sense of ego, a very extant, a very solid, and in often solidifying, strengthening sense of self. And that's not service to other. That's service to illusion. Service to self is service to illusion. It's the power of falsity, Ross said. And so the reversal of cards 8 and 11 is very significant. And in fact, Mr. Rider-Waite, one of these guys, actually wrote about it and said, well, I did that to protect the secret for the non-initiates and those who are outside the order.
Wow. That's wild.
Well, that's often the case here. So, so if we go back to mind, anyway, the reason then body has come second is because it's really advanced work. It's transformation of the energy system, the chakras and the nadis, through will. But that's really properly only done after clearance of second, third chakra blockages quite substantially, quite fully.
Right. Okay.
Okay?
Yep.
So then what happens is the matrix is where you start. It's the condition in this case of consciousness or mind without its own connection to its depths. Then there's the potentiation of mind. The potentiation of mind comes by the response to catalyst, which is card three. Catalyst is all that impinges on the senses. And so in the Buddhist system of the skandhas, it's form, meaning having a body that gives us sensation, one and two. It's perception, which are the qualities of mind and body that can identify or discriminate or discern, you know, cognize experience. That perception leads then to what's called volitional formations or fermentations or thoughts, feelings, which is the fourth skanda. So form and sensation or feeling, perception, and then these volitional formations, thinking and feeling, emotions, you know, emotional thought, belief, and directed mind contents. These are forms of catalyst also. That's what arises within us and how we meet experience. So my talking to you is a catalyst and you're sitting in your chair is a catalyst. Anything from the outer world, so-called, and others is catalyst that, you know, that touches us in any way. Anything that occurs within our body-mind system is also catalyst. The proper use or efficient use of catalyst is to use that catalyst for continued positive polarization for those who are positive, which is most everyone. That use or proper or efficient use of catalyst is then what leads to experience. And so the interesting point there is that situations in and of themselves don't have an emotional charge. You can't make me angry. Only I can make me angry.
Right.
And so we very much misidentify causation always and say, you did it to me. You hurt me so much. You make me so angry. That situation makes me so sad. That's a scary place. No, the place isn't scary. You don't make my mind. The mind or the contents of consciousness are made by ourselves in response to catalyst, in relation or in reference to the degree of true potentiation of consciousness we've done, which means how well you can know and accept and understand what's happening inside and out, coming at you, coming up in you. Whatever comes up in us, whatever comes out, comes to us, is catalyst. How we work with it, how we respond, how we react, how we change, is then our experience. And so in the deck, card 3 is the Empress and card 4 is the Emperor.
So why is that then this male? Why is Catalyst female and the experience male here?
Now you're asking me a hard question. Well, let me say what Ra said. This was from session 78. They said, the third archetype may broadly be grasped as the catalyst of the mind. Thus, it takes in far more than disciplined meditation. Meaning, the question was asking, is this about meditation? And no, it's not really. However, it's certainly through this faculty or by meditation that catalyst is most efficiently used, which is a hint to the wise that Buddhist meditation or meditation that involves non-manipulation of the mind, but observing and understanding in any way, is a means of making good use of catalyst. And so that's why people sit in meditation, like Vipassana, not every type of meditation for sure, but they may sit in mindfulness, breath mindfulness, and then strong catalyst arises of thoughts and feelings and emotions and sensation. And by the stability of that condition, watching the breath without grasping, one can understand what's happening in the mind. And then, of course, your life. You can understand your life better by understanding what it's all about. And that's done very well in Vipassana. So then, Ra saying, this archetype 3 is perhaps confusedly called Empress, although the intention of this number, 3, is the understanding that it represents the unconscious or female portions of the mind complex being first, shall we say, used or ennobled by the male or conscious portion of the mind. So, and say Ra said, thus the noble name. So what that means is that the female gender of card 3, being catalyst, represents the fine use of what of our life, what comes to us or what comes up in us, using that, using the unconscious in a respectful way, using the self-ennoblement of seeking within to make sense and make peace with our life. And in some ways, the Empress is a transformation or an ennoblement of the unconscious, and certainly of the conscious. So in a certain way, using catalyst well, meaning when there's a potentiated consciousness, mind is seeking with love and openness to understand, to make peace with, to accept and know well. This is a self-ennoblement too. And the feminine quality of it is the quality of the unconscious as feminine or inspiration. That which awakens or brings life to, brings vitality to conscious mind. And so Ra's saying it's representing the unconscious, which is the female portion of mind complex, being first used or ennobled by the male or conscious. And so there's a self-ennobling to our deep mind, and of course to ourself, our consciousness, by seeking within to make use of catalyst. Not, you know, it's like I say something to you and you have a certain emotional reaction, which you made, and then you look within to understand what's it all about. that seeking within to make sense and good use of the experience in balance is ennobling and is some kind of respectful way of being with ourselves, with the deep mind.
It seems quite similar to the potentiator.
Yes, except for the fact that this represents stages of the evolution of each complex.
Okay.
And so the first stage is what you start with, matrix. Mm-hmm. The second stage is the other aspect of what you start with. What you start with is above ground and potentia. It's kinetic.
Right. Yeah, and conscious.
Right. So when we say the mind that lives the life, that mind is both conscious and unconscious. What the specifics of living the life is basically what those two do together in meeting what we call experience, which is catalyst, meaning what happens inside and outside coming to us, being the catalyst, is met by the combined forces of conscious and unconscious.
Okay.
And that then leads to the transformation of ourselves into experiencing, into experiencers. Mm-hmm. Are you experienced?
Mm-hmm.
Said Jimi Hendrix. So the experience is different than the catalyst. And the quality of what you end up with, meaning how I'm experiencing, is a function of the play between conscious and unconscious as that meets catalyst, as it reacts to catalyst.
Hmm.
So a matrix and potentiator is the subject, two aspects of subject. Catalyst can be called object. And the transformation of subject by the interplay with object is experience. And that leads then to recognition of significator, which is the transformed subject of matrix and potentiator, or the true nature of each. And so card 5 is called the Hierophant, or the Pope was actually called once upon a time. And interestingly, it looks a little bit different than in the Rider-Waite deck. So the significator is what you have, is sort of the fundamental nature of each of the seven when work has been done.
Let me see.
Each of the three.
Each of the three. Each of the.
Yeah. So the three being mind, body, spirit.
Okay.
So the significator is basically in the case of mind, I understand significator to be soul, which is very interesting. And because it's the fruit of distilled catalyst, being self-chosen and created experience when there's some degree of transformation or seeking. So the soul, metaphysically, is that which persists through the incarnation at a higher level, but it's not the same as higher self. So in Alice Bailey material, Theosophy, there's some discussion of the soul as distinct from the monad, or which is a higher self. In other metaphysical sources, there's an understanding that higher self is a little bit outside the whole situation, because late 6D is very far in mind from 3D. It's available, but the pathways to it are normally not well opened. The way to get there is the ennoblement of catalyst, or the ennoblement of self, or our being, making good use of experience, or catalyst. You know,
What do you mean by ennoblement?
Ennoblement it's a good term, a good question. It's the qualities of grace and harmony, broad-minded magnanimity, ease,
right,
calm, peace, stability.
Right.
Not forced, but as the result of clearing conflict, clearing inner conflict.
Yeah, the higher aspects of the situation.
The higher aspects of our being.
Okay.
I mean, you know, the soul, the self is a being of infinite worth. Higher self is the consciousness of complete and whole and perfect.
Mm-hmm.
The higher self, or our true being, is a perfectly balanced expression of love and wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
So a perfectly balanced expression, development of love, wisdom, heart and throat, fourth and fifth chakra,
mm-hmm.
Is a noble condition. And again, you know, anybody can use any term any way they want, but Ra's really talking about the release of self-conflict, the release of distortion, the healing of distortion, which is the clearing of lower chakra blockage, 2 and 3, leading to the presence of soul and our greater being in the conscious mind, through the conscious mind.
Mm.
It's kind of God speaking through the instrument, but it's not an outer God, it's our true spiritual being, right. Our own being. And that would be a blend of pure understanding of love, wisdom.
Hmm. Scott, I did not expect to get into this kind of depth actually when I started this conversation, but it's fascinating.
Yeah, well, this is why this is in the fourth volume, and that's why very few people have read it.
Yeah.
Oh, and this is, you know, we're just scratching the surface here.
Yeah, I can see what all these guys in the mystery schools were doing with all their spare time.
Yeah, well, you see, the problem is that the mystery schools, as I see them now, are basically all left-handed. And okay. They're all funneling people into service to self, more or less.
Wow.
Because you don't need magic or ritual to develop love and wisdom. That's not even what they're doing. They're interested in power. So the positive path is based in the power, the intrinsic power of truth, which is the truth of unity, which is love and honesty. So it's honesty to realize the truth of unity. And that truth of unity is an expression of the infinite love of the Creator, which is the creation, which is the identity of love and light. Mm. Light or energy or matter is by nature an expression of infinite love. And so that's power enough, I think. Ritual not needed.
Yeah. So, well, I mean, just coming from a real beginner's point of view, I look at the tarot and, you know, there are all these esoteric symbols and all this symbology. I mean, I lump it together with the mystery schools, but obviously it's more complicated than that, right?
Well, again, mystery schools are all different. I really don't have a lot of experience or knowledge in the study of that.
Okay.
A lot of what they're doing is technique.
Okay.
Ra said, begin and end in the Creator, not in technique.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think technique is important. And also, one of the key realizations at the first level of enlightenment in Buddhism, called Sotapanna, means stream entry, stream entrant, is the first penetration of intelligent infinity in Ra's system. Mm-hmm. In Buddhism, it's the first of 4 levels of enlightenment in the Pali Theravadan old system. One of the key realizations is the futility of rites and rituals for enlightenment.
Mm.
Meaning the person realizes that it really wasn't meditation that did this, even though they may have done a lot of it.
Mm.
It's a transformation of awareness.
Right.
And that's not done by technique, although technique can help us make that change.
Would you say it's the intent?
Well, again, yes, the intent is important, of course. Intent is very important. But we are not fully aware of our intentions, and that's the problem. And so I think a lot of people who are doing rites and rituals and technique don't realize that they're doing it partially in the service of low self-esteem, partially in the service to make themselves feel stronger,
yep,
or smarter or superior or capable. It's an emotional comforting that they're involved in it.
Yeah, it's almost like a crutch.
I think so. I think so. It's actually a defensive position, not looking at what's very painful in their mind. What's very painful in their mind is how they think about themselves and their relations with others and aspects of their history that they haven't healed, that they haven't loved, that still cause grief and conflict. You see, to the extent that anybody is not happy with themselves or not well in themselves, there's emotional wounding unhealed. To the extent that I need anything from anybody emotionally, I am unhealed. Period. The Buddha needs nothing. Nityananda needs nothing. They need nothing from anyone. They're just fine. And that's because they have become totality. They've realized they are totality. And so there's no more emotional, there's no more hole to fill. There's no more void in the heart. There's no more self-conflict. There's no more sense of separate self. And so everybody who's doing rites and ritual comes there with a damaged sense of self, with distortions and a sense of ego. Ego is nothing. Ego is a dream. And so they're doing it to make themselves feel better, which is fine, but it strengthens their sense of self, which is not fine. So, I mean, it's fine for me, but it's not the way to freedom from suffering. And then they get some power, either organizationally or metaphysically. They can do stuff magically, and or they're risen to some higher ladder point in the organization. That only strengthens their sense of self. Or they use that to strengthen their sense of self. That pulls them right onto the left-hand path.
Yeah, it's quite a seductive thing, isn't it?
I mean, I was into seeking powers in my 20s. And then I, and first of all, the Taoists are against it. There are two types of Taoists, Chinese Taoists. There's the guys, the philosophical Taoists, like Lao Tzu, Tao Te Ching, and Chuang Tzu, Lao Tzu. And these guys actually look down on the gymnastic Taoists, those who did breathing practice and those who did very special meditation, even. Which I'm not against for sure, but the view from Lao Tzu, Chuang Tzu is that it's all the flow, and you need wisdom, not technique. And when there's deep wisdom, accepting the reality, the greater reality or reality from a greater view, it's okay if I die tomorrow. And it's okay if I feel happy or sad or healthy or sick. I don't think it's. I think it's good to do some of those exercises, frankly. But their view is that it's the transformation of mind that's key, and it's living in truth that you really want.
Now, Scott, not to I love to finish off the thread with the seven with transformation of the mind and great way of the mind, just to finish off that seven set there. Do you want to do that before we go on to
Okay,
other?
well, the card after experience of mind is significator of mind. That's card five. And basically, the significator, Ross says, the significator of each mind, body, and spirit, which is cards 5, 12, and 19, may be seen as a simple and unified concept, because here we're talking about concepts, these 22 cards. The matrix of this significator of Ross says the significator of the body is its very nature, or the significator of mind, sorry, is its very nature. And I call that soul, they say. And the soul is actually a higher dimensional field, consciousness field, that we return to in a certain way after death. It's what remains as sort of the sun shining over us through the long period of incarnation. And when we die, we return to soul consciousness. So It's Ra calls it the heart of the mind complex, the card five, the significator of mind. The heart of the mind, heart or essence of mind complex, they say, is that dynamic entity which seeks, absorbs, and attempts to learn. That's very heavy. And so the soul is that which is the heart of mind. It's the result of conscious mind potentiated by itself, by the deep mind, meeting catalysts to provide a refined experience. Example is, you're standing, Ra gave this example, I think. Somebody's standing at the checkout counter and the person in front of you is slow. One person gets angry, one person doesn't care, and the other person feels sorry for the person who's not finding their money and has some problem. The person who gets angry is using that catalyst of the slow checkout for the development of service to self. Anger separation. The person who doesn't care is not using the catalyst at all. That's very common down here on the ground, people not using their catalyst or life experience in any
Yeah,
way.
just unconsciousness.
Yeah, that's avidya, ignorance, or indifference. Ra called the vast sinkhole of indifference. The vast sinkhole of indifference. Ra said, one who knows not cares not. And that's the basic condition of spiritual sleep. Sleepers, sheeple, whatever you want to call it, non-seeking truth. And so the third person uses that catalyst to continue on the spiritual positive path. They feel compassion. So, I mean, I had a case many, many years ago. I gave a lecture in, I don't know, Long Island or something. Not one person came. And I'm sitting there in a big hall, not that big, but a little big, with five empty chairs arranged around me. And I moved through anger, sorrow, disappointment, into actually some joy twice. One was a sense that, oh, you know what? You're not alone. We're here. You're not alone. And I could feel the presence of positive beings with me. And the second was on the train coming back to Manhattan. This is the 90s or 80s or something, a long time ago, maybe in the 90s. And I felt so happy that I had done my part, and it's okay, nobody came. And I realized that, the disappointment was empty, the emptiness of the disappointment. And I realized, oh, it's great. And even that I'm well. Even with that I'm well. And that was, it was of joy. I really felt joy. The Croton Hudson line or whatever that is coming back. So Penn Station. So that was another particular use of the catalyst.
Yeah, that's a beautiful example, and I think that really solidifies what we're talking about here to real life. You know, I'm just reminded of this. Do you know who Byron Katie is?
Yes, but I don't know her work really.
Well, she related this story which I heard yesterday. I'm just reminded of this. You know, her wallet was stolen, and you know, with it was all her trinkets and all her valued possessions. And I think she was a little bit angry, but then later she had this thought which she then related to the audience, and it was, I wonder who has that now. You know, it's like, you know, it's a this joy for this person who's found her treasure. And that again is exactly what we're saying here, using that catalyst in a service to others way, isn't it?
Yeah, it's Ra calls it the refined use of catalyst, the efficient use of catalyst, and it's very subtle. It's basically providing yourself with distilled catalyst or distilled experiencing, and as we continue on the spiritual path, that happens more and more. So the person, you see life through the eyes of love, right? You see, now that needs wisdom too, but you see that with people who are loving, only, or love over wisdom. I mean, sincerely, not trying to be, but naturally they're good heart, and they feel others' pain. They know their Brahma Viharas, the four Buddhist meditations on compassion and loving kindness.
Mm.
And so when they see this and that, they can feel for people. And that's because they've developed heart chakra and somewhat of a freedom from self-involvement. And that's reality. And so it's like somebody, they lose their house in the flood, right? Recently in New York City, Long Island, New Jersey, a lot of places got really terribly flooded. And I'm sure there's probably one or two or three people, not many maybe, who actually feel good at some level because they say, you know what? That's just stuff. I'm here and my family's here and we love each other and everything's okay. Because even though we need that stuff or we like that stuff and we miss it all and we're really difficult situation materially, what's really important is that we're together and we love each other. I bet a lot of people felt that.
Yeah.
And that is a distilled experiencing of very painful catalyst. And that is ennobling.
That's a very interesting, well, ennobling. What's your take on Hurricane Sandy and you know, in current times?
Are you drawing me into the conspiratorial dialogue?
No, I mean, yes, and, well, I mean, just a commentary on current events, I guess, is what I'm asking for.
Well, I would just say that in all cases of so-called natural disasters, probably in the last 30 years or more, one has to consider both the causative activity of earth changes.
Yeah.
Which is the transformation of the body of Earth to prepare for its fourth density cycle, and then also human technology, which is used by those who are service to self, who seek a new world order, who do order through chaos, and divide and conquer, and never let a good crisis go to waste, and manufacture many.
So do you think it was HAARP related?
No, I think everything is, all of these things are HAARP related. I mean, I mean, you see, this is a case of how I process some of this catalyst. I assume that it's all probably both. Not all, but I assume it's probably all, probably both.
Yeah.
Probably most, certainly most is probably all or both. Probably, okay. You know, probably most of these disasters are a combination of human and natural cause. And that's really enough for me because they have a million plans and a subplots and I'm not really interested. And but you can assume, I mean, I think there's weather warfare going on.
Yeah, I think so too.
I mean, Russia, US, China, East, West, you know, there's a lot of it. So I just assume that's a lot, that's partly related to most major disasters these days.
I find it really odd that Hurricane Sandy just went straight for the East Coast in a kind of like, the path of it was just kind of weird. It was almost like directed, but anyway.
Yeah, well, these are called directed energy weapons and they can direct energy and therefore they can direct weather conditions. So, I mean, I just assume that all of this is probably caused by both.
Right, we've ventured a bit off the tarot here.
Yeah.
Are you okay? Do you want to take a break?
No.
Okay.
So
let's talk about the transformation of the mind and Great Way.
It's fine. I was just looking at something here.
Right.
So when we understand then that the significator of mind is the heart of mind complex, because again, we have mind complex, seven cards, body complex, spirit complex. The heart of each of those three is the fifth position or significator card. And so what's interesting again is that the soul, the essence of our own mind, card five, Ra calls the dynamic entity which absorbs, seeks, and attempts to learn. And that's the a life lived consciously. And that's the desire to make good use of our life experience down here on the ground. Absorbing or seeking, and then absorbing and seeking to learn. They didn't say learning. Ra said attempting to learn. So we can't really force learning, but we can continue to attempt to learn. Mm-hmm. Ra is very humble. And so that's card five.
Mm-hmm.
And it has a noble quality to it. Then when you get out of that, you get to card six, which is transformation of mind, also called the lovers. In all decks, it's called the lovers.
Mm-hmm.
And interestingly, in the Egyptian deck and the modern Egyptian deck, not in Rider-Waite, there's a figure, a fellow, who's standing at the crossroads of two paths, left and right, looking like a pyramid, actually, flanked by two women, one who is scantily clad and one who is politely clad, mm-hmm. meaning one gives herself easily and one requires the courtship.
Mm-hmm.
The difference between rape and courtship.
Mm-hmm.
The difference between the negative path and the positive path.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is a card about choosing path.
Mm-hmm.
And so when there's some potentiation of the conscious mind by seeking within, then we meet our catalyst in a conscious way, what we call conscious, which means seeking to make good use of it and understand it. And that leads to distilled experience, which leads to the understanding of soul or the heart of mind. When that's achieved, then there has to be clear choosing of one's path. Normally there is some choosing before that, but it's the soul, it's from a soul level, or from soul in mind, the heart of mind being lived, a deep connectedness within, and making good use of our life, that leads us to be on our path, to mm-hmm. choose and be and follow our path. And so both Egyptian decks show the figure between two women choosing his lover. And it shows him actually staring forward, not having yet chosen or not having made the choice, because it's fine if souls go left or right. That's allowable. That's the law of free will. And so the essence of that card, the lovers, let me say here, is basically making a clear choice of how we use our soul, how we use our life, how we use the potentiated mind.
Mm-hmm. So this relate to the, I mean, I'm obviously thinking sixth density here. And at 6D, there is this merger of the positive, well, the STO and the STS paths. Is that related to what this is saying?
No, because this is not the completion of polarity, but the inception of polarity. This is really about the 3D soul. This is all 3D, you know. So this is the 3D soul making clear choice of path.
Okay.
Ra said, this was session 99, mm-hmm. very close to the end.
Mm-hmm.
Let us now observe the evaluation of the two females. The observation that to the left-hand path moves the roughly physical, and to the right-hand path, the mental, has a shallow correctness. Don had asked, is it that the left-hand path is just physical and the right-hand path is mental? Ra says it has a shallow correctness. The Ra is not a softie, you know. They're just telling it like it is. Your view that it's you know, left-hand path is a physical basis, right-hand is mental, is not quite true. There are deeper, they say, there are deeper observations to be made concerning the relationship of the great sea of the unconscious mind to the conscious mind, which may fruitfully be pursued. So it's actually, this is an, are you breathing? Are you okay?
I'm okay, I'm okay. Yeah, yeah.
All right, so I heard you puffing, like.
No. No, 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 it wasn't me.
Okay.
That's interesting that you're hearing that.
Yeah, maybe it was the guy on the other end. He's getting sweating with the headset. So Ra said, there are deeper observations to be made concerning the relationship of the great sea of the unconscious mind to the conscious mind. And you see, this is an interesting point. When we say positive path of love and unity, or negative path of separation and control, these are not simply descriptors of how the person relates to others. Mm-hmm. It's particularly a descriptor of how one relates conscious mind to the unconscious. Mm-hmm. How you relate to your unconscious is how you relate to others. And there are only two organized ways of doing it. Control and domination, subjugation and ordering, or love, acceptance, harmony, and peace.
Mm.
Left-hand path, right-hand path. So how the conscious mind relates to the unconscious, how we relate to ourselves, in common parlance, is how we relate to others. And that is ultimately the foundation of which path we're on.
Mm.
Ra goes on. Many, this is the left-hand fellows, maybe the guy who's breathing, many use the trunk and roots of mind as if that portion of mind were a badly used prostituted entity, meaning a used whore. Mm. That's how negatives use their deep mind, like a whore. Mm. Then this entity gains from this great storehouse that which is rough, prostituted, and without great virtue. Indeed. Mm. That's the way those on the left-hand path relate to themselves, meaning how conscious mind relates to the unconscious.
Mm.
And it's very interesting, they say, badly used prostitute, rough prostituted without great virtue.
Mm.
And that's because they use the deep mind to dominate others. And they don't appreciate the true nature of deep mind, which is love, which is love, which is heart, which is soul, which is very beneficent. So they're not into that.
Yeah.
On the other hand, Ra says, those who turn to the deep mind, seeing it in the guise of the maiden, go forth to court it. This courtship has nothing of plunder in its semblance. It doesn't seem, it's not plunderous, and it may be protracted. The path is long. Yet the treasure gained by such careful courtship is great. The right-hand and left-hand transformations of the mind may be seen to differ by the attitude of the conscious mind towards its own resources, as well as the resources of other selves.
Mm.
So this is heavy duty, you know?
Yeah, I see that.
The pivot of the lovers, card 6, transformation of mind, is the quality by which we relate to deep mind.
Mm.
And those on the negative path use the resources of deep mind in a shallow way, actually. And there's much off limits to them by their path. While those on the positive path seek to appreciate the totality of what they are, what I am.
Mm.
I wish to be whole. I wish to be the totality of what I am. That's very different than the negative project, the negative self project.
It's very interesting. I mean, to me, I'm just kind of reminded of how much, exactly as you say it, it's like rape versus making love.
Yeah.
Right. And we see a lot of that reflected in society, you know, all this obsession with S&M versus, you know, obviously the more difficult, in a sense, tantric path of really deeply understanding your partner and having deep communion with her.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. You know, all of society is teaching people to rape themselves. All of society Really, I mean, to a large extent, people are taught to abuse themselves. They're taught to disrespect themselves. They're taught not to appreciate your sanctity. They're taught to obey authority, not to discover your own inner authority. So society on Earth is basically a big fraud, in the sense that it's led by benevolent protectors. It's led by rapacious negatives, generally. I mean, it's actually always been that way, more or less, but its pervasive influence is greater today than before. So that's the we're not one big happy family here, because the parents are psychopathic, very deeply wounded people in this in most societies on Earth. Not all, and it depends, but people, yeah, the presentation of sex in the media is absolutely not of the way of love and appreciation and understanding and harmony. It's, the difference between fucking and making love.
Definitely.
And you see, what happens is, if people are constrained and their aspirations for freedom and happiness are denied and frustrated repeatedly by the strictures of society, then people grow resentment towards, it's a free-floating resentment. I'm angry at life. People who hate God, people who walk around, it's very easy with a lot of anger, and a lot of people have. And that anger has to go somewhere. And where it often goes is into the negativization, or the bastardization of sexuality. And that's considered okay. So, I mean, the real thing is that people in this world have been led to direct their attention far from their essence. Distraction, anonymity, and sleep, all set. And I see this all the time. I see people, and I see them acting a certain way that they feel is going to make others happy, or presents a certain image to society, or they're so proud of their high position, or they're very concerned with what others are doing, or they've shaped themselves according to the trend or the fad. It's so self-disrespecting. It's such a dismissal of our true nature. It's such a redirection of mind away from the heart of mind, away from the inner bounty to the outer dust. And it's sad. And that's why the people here will repeat, why there'll be a very significant repeating percentage of the human population after 3 years over.
Now I want to ask you about the tarot and characters looking left or right. What does that mean?
Well, you ask hard questions. It's basically about the intrinsic, it's about the place of polarity in a particular card. Okay? So, and the relationship between the characters and polarity. So, in the card of the Transformation of Mind Lovers, card six, the scantily, it's hard to see on the Egyptian deck because it's black and white. But the left-hand path would be associated, or the woman on the left, looking left, is associated with left-hand path. And her quality is the quality of the left-hand path, which again is how the person uses the deep mind. The man is looking forward because he hasn't chosen the path yet. In card seven, Great Way of the Mind, it's called the Conqueror, or the Chariot, the Charioteer. It's the last card of the first series of seven, right? In the original, he's facing to his left, holding a sphere, and in the other hand, a downward pointing sword. And in the Rider-Waite deck, which is from the occultists, he's basically looking forward. And that's interesting, with no sphere in his hand, and in fact his left hand is empty. he's holding, it's interesting, you know, in the Rider-Waite deck and others, the original sphere being held by a character, one of the cards, has been replaced by a scepter. And that's so human. It's so such a distortion added by the negatives, as there have been many here, because the sphere is a sign of holistic, unified, magical power. It's the power of the One, which is infinite power available to those on the positive path. Now, it's replaced by the scepter, which is linear, angular, phallic, and a symbol of human rulership over other humans. While the sphere is basically a little sun. And wow, that's yet another distortion added by the astrological community, or the occultists, who put together Rider-Waite and the other decks that came from it.
I mean, it seems to me that there's just so many little traps that you wouldn't know about if you go about learning the tarot. I mean, what would be your advice to someone who's like me, who's starting out on this, you know, looking into this stuff?
Well, I mean, you know, choose your teacher wisely. Choose your teachers carefully. I keep a high standard, and I choose carefully. And I don't want to waste time, and I don't want, you know, garbage. So for me personally, you know, raw material, original Buddhism, some Taoism, some yoga philosophy, even some Western metaphysics, and even a couple of channelings like Seth or Hilarion are just fine for me and enough. For tarot, I mean, if you respect the raw material, then one should consider what Ross said about tarot. And that's either from my PDF or you find it in the fourth volume on your own. And see what they have to say. But, you know, just make sure that it feels right, or it feels like that the effect of using it is transformation. You know, the way you know if something, the way you know if food is good for you is when it feels good. It's good in your belly and your body feels well with it. Same thing with spiritual teaching. The way you know it's good for you is that you feel well after you've received it. That doesn't mean that it's high, and it doesn't mean that you see everything in terms of the teacher and the organization behind him. It just means that that teaching for you was suitable and suited, and you used it well. And it doesn't mean that a year from now you may leave because you find that it's not right, or something doesn't fit, or something is off base. But you have to use your discernment.
I actually want to ask you about the I Ching, but that's a totally different topic.
I know. I like the I Ching a lot. I've been using it since the late 70s when I was in high school. So I know a little bit about it, but I'm not expert.
Okay, cool.
But anyway, the final card of the first seven, Great Way of Mind, Chariot, Charioteer, Conqueror, Ross says, Archetype 7 is one difficult to enunciate. We may call it the path, the way, or the great way of the mind. Its foundation is a reflection and substantial summary of archetypes 1 through 6. So that means that in each of the three series, body and mind, body, spirit, cards 7, or the seventh position card, which is 7, 14, 21, represents a reflection or summary, substantial summary of the substance of the first six cards, the cards or six before that. The great way of mind, then Ross says, one may see the great way of mind as showing the kingdom or fruits of appropriate travel through the mind, in that the mind continues to move as majestically through the material it conceives of as a chariot drawn by royal lions or steeds. So there's a lot of, I mean, that's a very loaded sentence. That's just one sentence there. The great way of mind, the way of mind, card 7, conqueror, charioteer, He's holding a sphere, and he's holding a sword, but it's pointed straight down, which in a way shows he's put down the sword. He holds it, but he's not wielding it against anything. This is the kingdom or fruits of appropriate travel through the mind. Now, where are you now? You're in your room. Is it outside or inside? Well, you can say it's outside because it's outside my body. But how do you know that? I know it by my eyes, senses, and my intellect. Is that outside your body or inside?
It's outside. Well, hold on.
Senses,
Inside, inside, yeah, inside.
well, it's inside and outside, right? Are you your eye? No. Are you your eye perception? No. Are you your thoughts? No. Those are the passing clouds in the sky. Yet, what we conceive of, or my experience, right, of the catalyst of sitting in my room, or my experience, which I conceive of as a me sitting in this room, which is mine, all of that is in your mind. The outer inner split is in your mind. It's your mind that conceives of the duality of location, inner and outer. It's the mind that conceives of the duality of past, present, future. And so that's why Ra says this shows the fruits or kingdom, the achievement of appropriate or efficiently used catalyst, travel through the mind. Your journey of life is through your mind. Ra said, you're not living in a material universe. You are dancing thoughts. You are dancing thoughts. Whose thought? The thought of the one infinite thinker. The thought of the creator of all, which thinks this light. This dancing light, which is a dancing thought in the mind of the one infinite, is not inner or outer, but we conceive it by travel through the mind. So your life is not a travel in the outer world, or your outer travel in the world is your mind conceiving of outer travel in the world. The mind conceives of, I used to be a child and now I'm adult and later I'll be old. The mind conceives that. The mind conceives how you think of yourself and how you think of your life and how you define everything.
That's obviously the Buddhist and Hindu concept that the world's a dream.
Well, the Buddhist statement was, things are not as they appear, nor are they otherwise. Things are not as they appear, meaning how we conceive of life and ourself and this experience, is much more, what we conceive of it is a very small portion of what it is. But what it is includes our conception of it. So it's like depth and breadth. If I put my hand in front of my face, I say, oh, there's my hand in front of my face. If I put my hand 1 inch in front of my face, I just say, oh, there's some dark pink thing. Now, if I go further in, there's no more hand, there's cells, or atoms. That level of depth gives me a very different experience. So which is it? Is it cell? Is it hand? Is it pink blotch? Well, it's all of that, but it's more than that. So if I see it as a hand, because I'm far away from it, I think, oh, it's just my hand. Well, that's not the total truth. From this perspective, with my mind, I say it's my hand. But from a different perspective, with a different condition of mind, I'll see it differently. When a fly looks at my hand, he sees heat signature. Right? So the heat signature vision is fundamentally not separate from my vision of my hand. I call it my hand, and Mr. Fly calls it a particular field of heat signature. And so things are not as they appear. If it as it appears is one aspect of what it is, but it's much more than that. So you can't really say that it is only how it appears, nor is it otherwise. meaning what it is includes my limited perception of its appearance. And so you can say it's not that illusion is real. You see, form is emptiness and emptiness is form. Form is empty means you call it your hand, but it's a whole lot more. And if you are aware of all of that, you wouldn't call it your hand. You would say that it can appear as a hand and it can appear many other things too. So the form, calling it just what I think it is empty. It's much more than that, and it's also always in flux, and there's much more happening than I perceive. The form that I define is empty of eternal meaning, of fixed and unchanging meaning as I define it, as I experience it. Meanwhile, emptiness is form, which means if you think of it as nothing, that's another type of form. If you think of it as illusion, oh, I have no self, I'm a no self, we have no self. It's the Buddhist teaching is not no self, even though it's called anatta. It's basically the whole discussion of self and no self is far from the truth. That's the point. Things are not as they appear, but they're also not otherwise, and so appearance has a relative truth to it. And the reality is far from the limited perception that we have. And that's what Ra says, travel through the mind. And so your whole life is in your mind, in a sense. Outer and inner is a distinction made by limited perception. So Ra says it shows the kingdom or fruits of appropriate travel through the mind, in that the mind continues on the path to move as majestically through the material it conceives of as a chariot drawn by royal lions or steeds. So the mind, our life is a form of travel through the mind as we move through the material we conceive. All of our thoughts are material volitional formations, just the skanda. That we're conceived. We're living through our conception. And so where's the inner, where's the outer? And yet we take it all as solid and real. That's the teaching of illusion, the idea that self is illusion, life is illusion, ego is illusion, is to counter the belief in permanence and substantiality. Once one realizes that substantiality is a dream, then you have to understand that our conception of emptiness is also a dream. And so that's why Buddhism doesn't talk about unity, even though true Buddhism, in my view, true is the Theravadan Pali canon, and that's it. Sorry, everybody else. So Buddha doesn't talk about unity, never. Never. The Buddha doesn't say, oh, the one true nature. No, the Mahayanists and the Tibetans do that. The Pali canon doesn't do that. The original Gautama didn't talk that way. Because the teaching of unity is a temporary expedient means to heal the delusion of duality. Once that's been healed, then one has to realize that there is no substantiality to unity either. It's really called infinity.
So what about the law of one?
Ra's in late 6D, they're not in 8.
Interesting.
Hear, hear.
Wow. So would you say that original Buddhism and what you've encountered is probably the highest, quote-unquote, teaching that you've found so far?
You know, again, Ra doesn't say everything. The Buddha doesn't say everything. Zhang Su, Lao Tzu, they don't say everything either. In my view, the raw material, the Law of One from L&L Research and Carla Ruckert, nobody else, not any other purported channeler of Ra, that this presentation of the Law of One through Carla Ruckert is the highest presentation or most accurate presentation of truth along with the Buddha, along with what I understand from Theravadan Buddhism. And that's it. The Buddha didn't talk about cosmology. The Buddha didn't even talk profoundly about karma. The Buddha had nothing to say about unity or higher self, nothing to say about ETs, except that the Buddha did talk about the devas and the asuras, higher dimensional positive and negative entities, actually. But yes, I would say that the original Buddhism, which is in the Pali Canon, and the Law of One through Karla Rukert, is about the best you can do. I mean, Nityananda was a great, was an avatar and a Buddha, and I think Nityananda is up there also. But that's just me.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. What about, last question. Well, I mean, we're going to start winding up soon because it's been a long session. What about the Advaita and you know, Ramana and all those guys?
Oh, I like Ramana Maharshi a lot. I think he's great. Definitely. Definitely. And I like the spirit of Yogananda. His organization is a different matter. And I really don't know about his teacher, Sri Yukteswar. But I like Ramana Maharshi a lot, for sure. I just don't know that. And I like Nisargadatta Maharaj, who is a student of Nityananda, by the way. So I like those. But almost everybody else I don't really care for much, you know, because I don't want a human teacher. He's human. I don't want a human teacher. I want a guy who's out of the situation.
Do you not think someone can be self-realized in human form?
Oh, of course they can. Absolutely. Nityananda was. Buddha was. Ramana Maharshi was. Is.
Yeah.
They all are.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Those guys are, no doubt. But they're also not human now.
Interesting. Have you heard of this guy called Muji?
Noji.
Muji.
No.
Okay.
Yeah, I know. No, I didn't know.
Okay, interesting. Well, I mean, he's a student of Papaji who was obviously a student of Ramana, and I met up with him recently. I interviewed him actually, and yeah, I you know, he made an impact on me. I'm just wondering if you heard of him.
No, I didn't.
Okay.
You know, everybody needs different stuff.
Yeah.
And so you've got to find what works for you, but don't assume that it's the penultimate, and be careful. Be careful.
Yeah.
If the guy is talking about ego, there's a problem.
Of course. Of course. Scott, thank you so much for being with us. Any kind of last things you'd like to mention?
I just give my website, or you give that on your links.
Yeah, I will. And I will give the link to the tarot and the archetypal mind PDF, because I think that's really necessary for what we've been talking about in these 2 hours.
Yeah, I would also say I do counseling by Skype, and if anybody wants a personal dialogue, so long as you're not an Illuminati faker agent, come my way. I get the Illuminati faker agents also, because they need help, but they don't know it. So they like to come to me also.
Gosh.
Yeah, I have had a not a history, but I've had many fake clients come to me who are Illuminati agents, and they're pretending to be clients, but they're doing some kind of trip, trying to lay a trip on me. So that's part of, be careful, you know. There are teachers, there are healers, there are big shots who are on the left-hand side, or they are agents in all the spiritual communities. I mean, all the fields, you know, like healers or channels or gurus or whatever. In all those different portions, there are people you really shouldn't be following. Unless you want trouble.
Gotcha.
But I would just say the study of tarot from Ra, as they presented it here, shows that the creator of the solar system, meaning the logos, the architect, the originator of the body-mind-spirit system we're using, that's heavy, right? The guy who made it, the triadic vehicle, body, mind, spirit that we use, wants us to grow and be happy and to be well. And the very nature of the architecture and the structure of deep mind contains an understanding of the whole path.
Mm.
And life is geared to evolution. Life is set up for soul evolution. That's what it's all about. Ra said the purpose of incarnation is the evolution of mind, body, spirit. Very simple.
Mm.
And, you know, it's the hope of the Creator that all beings develop themselves fully and realize their totality and happiness. And that's beautiful, you know. The sun is your friend. And so the one creation is filled, you know, is built from love. It's the substance of light itself is born of love. And that is fully present within ourselves.
Mm.
And if we seek, we find it.
It's an extremely wild journey, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a pretty interesting situation.
Scott, thank you so much again.
Yeah, thank you too.